All right, well, this evening, as I've already mentioned, we're going to be looking at really one verse in Psalm 27. But what I'd like to do is read the psalm as we begin, because it is a wonderful expression of love for the Lord and a desire, a trust in the Lord, I should say, as well, but a desire to see the Lord's glory. And by the way, I should mention as we read this, you know, what David was referring to were really the types and shadows. We actually have access to the reality through our Lord Jesus. If David desired to see that glory through the types and shadows, how much more should we desire to see it through the things that the Lord has given to us? Psalm 27, beginning in verse 1. David writes, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the defense of my life. Whom shall I dread? When evildoers came upon me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and my enemies, they stumbled and fell. Though a host encamp against me, my heart will not fear. Though war arise against me, in spite of this, I shall be confident. One thing I have asked from the Lord, that I shall seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to meditate in his temple. For in the day of trouble he will conceal me in his tabernacle. In the secret place of his tent he will hide me. He will lift me up on a rock. And now my head will be lifted up above my enemies around me. And I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, and be gracious to me and answer me. When you said, 'Seek my face,' my heart said to you, 'Your face, O Lord, I shall seek.' Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not abandon me nor forsake me, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a level path because of my foes. Do not deliver me over to the desire of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and such as breathe out violence. I would have despaired unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord." Again, we're going to be focusing mainly upon verse 4 of this passage. Now, we saw this morning, the first reason, the first motivation why we should seek the kingdom. We've already seen others. I had mentioned we should seek it, of course, because our Lord commands us to do so. And certainly, as the King of the universe and the Creator of all things, he has the right to tell us what to do, remembering, of course, that whatever he tells us to do is always for our good, and it's always the right thing. But as we saw this morning, we should also do this because of his love. Paul says, when we were helpless, when we were guilty, guilty enough to perish forever in hell, when our hearts were enslaved to sin, when we hated God and wanted nothing to do with him, God sent his Son into the world to live and to die, to be buried and to be raised so that we might live. We should seek the kingdom of heaven. We should love the Lord because Jesus was willing to come into this world to become a man, to live among a sinful race, to live among us, in order to work out our salvation, in order to humble himself to become a servant, in order to become a curse for us on the cross, taking his Father's full wrath for our sins. And we should be willing to do this, of course, because of the Lord's great love in sending his Spirit to raise us to life in order that we might believe, and then to empower us, to guide us, to comfort us in order that we might reach heaven. We should love him because this, Paul tells us, is what God had planned from all eternity. He loved us and determined to have mercy on us. When we were helpless, God saved us because of His infinite love towards us. Now, obviously, we can never repay Him for what He has done. But what we can do is respond in the way that He calls us to devote ourselves to Him, to put His kingdom first. But now again, as we were reminded this morning, His love for us is not our only motivation. We should put His kingdom first because of His love for us, but we should also do it because of our love for Him. And here I'll just remind you, I'm talking about a love that is more than just a love of gratitude. We should certainly love the Lord for what He has given us. I mean, what He has given us is beyond value. But there's another kind of love that comes from seeing the beauty of the Lord, seeing that He is worthy to be loved. And again, putting it in these terms, loving Him not just for the gift that He gives, but loving the giver Himself. Now, God is beautiful. God is worthy to be loved. Certainly, this is how David viewed Him. Again, he writes in our passage in Psalm 27, verse 4, "One thing I have asked from the Lord." I want you to notice, he says one thing. Did David only ask for one thing? No, but he puts it this way because this is the most important thing that he asked. "One thing I have asked from the Lord, that I shall seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to meditate in His temple." So David here is expressing his greatest desire, which was to live, to dwell in the Lord's house all the days of his life. Now, what he was referring to, of course, here was God's tabernacle. It was still many years before the temple was going to be built by Solomon, and even though he calls it a temple here, he does call it a tabernacle as well. There is a sense in which it is a temple, but it's not the temple. It is the tabernacle. Now, what David is expressing here is certainly the desire that he might have access to the tabernacle all the days of his life, or perhaps he meant something perhaps a little more intense. Maybe he was expressing here a degree of envy over the priests and the Levites who actually were in the temple or in the tabernacle continually because they were called by God to do this very thing. As a matter of fact, we read an expression of that desire. Even the Levites, remember there are the priests, the sons of Aaron, and then there are the Levites, the descendants of Levi, who were set apart by the Lord to minister in the tabernacle, in the temple. We actually have a psalm that was written by the sons of Korah, which would be Levites, in Psalm 84 that expressed this desire. And let me just mention as a little bit of background because we're going to look at this again in just a moment. Korah, as I've said, was descended from Levi, and so he was a Levite. His sons ministered in the tabernacle at the time of David. But if we recall the history of Korah, it's interesting because Korah was one who rebelled against the Lord and thought that as a Levite, he should and his family should be able to minister as priests before the Lord. So there was a bit of a rebellion, and there was a judgment from the Lord, and that took place really during the time of Moses. Now we're talking about a time later than that, which means that there were those who survived that judgment and who still minister before the Lord. Anyway, in Psalm 84, we read in verses 1 through 4 this expression of just desire, again, like David expressed. "How lovely are your dwelling places, O Lord of hosts! My soul longed and even yearned for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. The bird also has found a house, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may lay her young, even your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. How blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you." Now, there's certainly many reasons why those who love the Lord wanted to be in the house of God. And David wanted to dwell in that house for this specific reason, that he might see the beauty of the Lord and that he might meditate on that beauty. Now, as we think about this, we have to ask the question, what was the beauty that David saw? What was it that he was wanting to see continually and to meditate on? Did the Lord at certain times appear in the tabernacle, the cloud of glory perhaps, the Shekinah? Well, certainly that did happen on occasion, but I don't think that that's what David was referring to. God didn't reveal himself in that way, but it was in the tabernacle that God did reveal himself in other ways. And really, it had to do with what was going on in the temple. It had to do with the furnishings of the temple. And I'll just mention a few and what it is that David saw in them. In the outer court, remember, there was the bronze altar where the burnt offerings were made. And that reminded David that the wages of sin is death. I mean, why were the sacrifices being brought to be burnt on the altar? The soul that sins shall surely die, and the Lord allowed substitution. So it reminded him of the cost of sin, and also reminded him that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness, there is no approach to God. These sacrifices were very important. They reminded him of certain things regarding God. There was also the laver that was in the outer court that the priests would ceremonially cleanse themselves in before ministering to the Lord, reminding David of the need of personal cleansing before he could draw near to God. Now, within the larger tent itself was a smaller tent, the outer part, which was called the holy place. And inside the holy place was the table of showbread that reminded David of his need of God and the food that God supplies, the spiritual food, if he was to have life. There was the golden lampstand that was continually lit in the tabernacle that reminded David of the need of the light of God's truth to be able to show him the right way to live. There was the altar of incense. It showed him the need of prayer, the need of one to stand between him and God to reconcile him with God through sacrifice and through intercession, which is what, of course, the priesthood itself reminded him of. He needed someone to mediate between him and God, and the Lord provided these things. And of course, within that smaller tent was an even smaller tent, the inner tent known as the Holy of Holies, which the high priest would enter once a year to make atonement for God's people. In that tent was the Ark of the Covenant that had the mercy seat that was on top, a representation of the majesty of God, of his kingly authority. It was the throne of God. But it was also the place where the blood from the Day of Atonement was placed, again reminding him, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. In the Ark was a jar of manna, a memorial of God's mercy in the wilderness, that God would be true to his promise, that he would provide. There was Aaron's rod that budded, and this again has reference to that rebellion of Korah, because when Korah, Dathan, Abiram, and On, these Levites stood before the Lord, God said he would show which family he had chosen, and they put their staffs down, and Aaron's rod, which was a dead stick, budded. That staff was put into the ark to remind them who may minister before the Lord. And, of course, of the judgment of God, of those who would seek to do other than what the Lord had called them to do. Inside the ark also were the two tables of the covenant that God made with Israel, the law that God called them to obey, which if they kept, God would bless, and if they didn't keep it, God would punish. Over the mercy seat, as you know, the cherubim stretched out their wings over the mercy seat, over this throne of God, reminding David of the angelic host that day and night were guarding the throne of God. Now again, these were the things that David saw inside the tabernacle. But of course, he also understood what they meant. These things were beautiful to David for at least two reasons. First of all, they represented God's grace and his mercy. Now, we may not see that immediately, but we do need to realize that all the things that God put into this tabernacle had one purpose, And that was to reconcile God and man. This whole priesthood, all this intercession, this mediation, all these sacrifices, they were meant as again, something very gracious God gave to be able to bring man close to himself. Now, not those sacrifices themselves, but of course what they pointed to, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. As David looked at these things, he knew something of the promise that God had made to him, that he was going to raise up one of his descendants, one of his seed, seat him upon his throne. His kingdom would not come to an end, that this is the one who would be a blessing to all the nations. This is the one who would reconcile God and man. So as David looked at these things, first of all, he marveled at God's goodness and mercy, and certainly found that to be beautiful. By the way, that is what we focused on this morning, God's grace and mercy in giving his son for us that we might be saved. But these were beautiful for a second reason, and that's because they reminded David of what it is that makes God truly beautiful. And that is his grace and his mercy, but we can back up a step and find something that basically beautifies everything that has to do with God, and that is his holiness. Because it's his holiness that means that God will follow through on his promises. His holiness is his love for what is good, his love for what is right, his love of justice and righteousness, that he is a God who quite obviously cannot overlook sin. Now, I think we need to focus on this for a bit because this point is so very important. This ability to see the holiness of God as something that is actually beautiful is really the mark of God's Holy Spirit working savingly within our hearts. This is that that blessing that the Spirit of God gives to those that the Lord has mercy on. Now, we love the Lord, as we saw this morning, because of his love for us. But we also love him for the same reason that David loved him, because he is holy. That holiness is what makes God beautiful to us, beautiful to the believer. Now, how can we see that? Well, let me just ask you to imagine, if you will, a God like the true God, who has all of his attributes, all of his natural, we call his natural attributes, that of infinite time, infinite space, infinite knowledge and power, but who completely lacks his moral attribute of holiness, or attributes holiness, righteousness, grace, and mercy. He is unholy. A God who, in other words, is always everywhere, who knows everything that we've thought, everything that we've done, who has the power to do whatever he wants to do, but he isn't holy. Instead, he is evil, who could make a promise and break it, who could make life miserable for us in this world and then send us to hell forever because that's simply what he wanted to do, or take us to heaven and then maybe in a few years get tired of us and throw us out of heaven into hell simply because he felt like it. A God who is evil, who is capricious, but who has all the power and attributes of God. Now let me ask you a question. Could you love a God like that? Would that God be beautiful to you? Well, no, I think we would have to say if there was such a being like that, he would be the greatest monster imaginable. And I say that simply to point out this. It isn't God's natural attributes that make him beautiful. It's not his power. It's not his knowledge. It's not his eternality, his unchangeableness, and so forth that makes him beautiful. It is his moral attributes that make him beautiful. His holiness, his moral purity, his love for what is good. Now, it's interesting that the very thing that makes God beautiful to us, to every believer, and that actually objectively makes him beautiful if things are viewed correctly, that very thing that makes him beautiful is the very thing that makes him ugly to the unbeliever. It's what the unbeliever hates about God, because it is his moral attributes that make him dangerous to them, because they know it means that he will hold them accountable for the sins that they have committed, and he cannot overlook them. So what makes him beautiful to us is what makes him not beautiful or ugly to the unbeliever. Now, I want to tie that to what this tells us about the character of faith that the Spirit of God actually works within us. There's at least two kinds of faith that are mentioned in the Bible. The first one we call historic faith, where we believe that what the Bible says is true. We believe that things happen just as the Bible describes them. We have the conviction that Jesus is the Messiah, the confidence that he can do miracles, the assurance that he can save and will save everyone who comes to him. Historic faith. We believe those things to be true. Well, do you know that James says that that kind of faith is not enough to save us? Because there are those who have it and yet are not reconciled to God. They can have it and still be God's enemies. And why do I say that? Well, it's because of what James writes in James 2:19, and I've made reference to this passage numerous times, where James, writing to his imaginary adversaries, he's arguing, he goes, "You believe God is one. You do well. The demons also believe and shudder." Now, do you think the devil believes the Bible is true? Do you think the demons believe the Bible is true? Well, they know it's true. As a matter of fact, they're so convinced that they shudder, which means that they're shaking in their boots because they know what this means for them. Now, saving faith, the kind of faith that saves us, has the same belief in the truth as historic faith, but it does something different. Knowing what sin is, it turns from sin. Knowing who Jesus is, it looks to Jesus and trusts in him alone for salvation. What is the difference between historic faith and saving faith? Well, it is this view of the beauty of the Lord. It is love. Love for this one that offers himself to us as a Savior. Love that embraces him. Love that desires him. Now again, just because you believe something is true doesn't mean that you're going to love that truth. The demons, as I've mentioned, believe. They know it's true, but they don't love that truth. They shudder at it, again, because they know what God intends to do to them. In the same way, just because we might believe that Jesus is the only Savior of mankind, that isn't automatically going to give us the ability to love him or to want him. We must first see him as one who is worthy to be loved. And if we do, then we will embrace him. Then we will receive him. What it is that makes him appear worthy or beautiful to us is not, again, his natural attributes, and it's not necessarily just the fact that he's willing to save, because many people know he's willing to save, but they still won't come to him. The difference is that you must see this beauty in the Lord, the beauty of his holiness, his moral uprightness, and see it for what it is. This is the same thing that David saw in the temple of God. He saw the holiness of God, the glory of his holiness, his moral uprightness, and that's why he wanted to live in God's house. Now that is what the Spirit of God actually gives to us in the work of the new birth. This is not something that we can work up within ourselves. It's what Jesus was referring to when he said to Nicodemus in John 3, verse 3, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." And that is, of course, in the Lord Jesus Christ. And in verse 5, he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water," by which I believe he means natural birth, "and the Spirit," which is the new birth, "he cannot enter into the kingdom of God." So what does the Spirit of God do in the new birth? Well, first of all, he opens our eyes, but not only to see more clearly that the reality of the kingdom of heaven in the presence of the King, but he also allows us to see Jesus in a way that is that really reveals his beauty, the beauty of the King, the beauty of the kingdom, because he is a holy King. And because his kingdom is a kingdom of holiness. Now, this is really what caused us to embrace Jesus as our Savior. This is really all the Spirit of God has to do in order to change the whole direction of our lives. Why were we going away from God, and now we're going towards God? Well, it's because before we didn't love him because of his holiness, and now we love him because of his holiness. This is all the Spirit of God had to do to make us trust in Jesus, to love his people, to desire his worship, to walk in his ways, to do the things that he calls us to do, and to seek his kingdom. He simply opened our eyes to the beauty of holiness. Jonathan Edwards suggests, and I think he's right, that he gives us a new spiritual faculty. I was talking with Eddie about this a little bit earlier, and he described it in this way. How could a being, and he called it like a stick man, who lives in a two-dimensional world, how could he explain a three-dimensional world? Well, Jonathan Edwards put it this way. How could you ever explain to a person who is deaf what music sounds like or what music is? How could you? He doesn't have the faculty to hear it and experience it. How could you explain color to a person who's blind? They have no point of reference. They have no way of knowing what that is. How can you reveal the beauty of God's holiness to a person who doesn't have the faculty to see that beauty? Well, you really can't. The Spirit of God needs to give them that faculty. And that's what he does when he has mercy upon us, when he gives us that blessing of the new birth. He opens our eyes to see that beauty to the point where now, having seen it, we cannot live without it. But our desire is to see it all the time. Again, David wanting to live, to dwell all the days of his life in the tabernacle of the Lord, to behold the beauty of the Lord. So this is what gives us our second motivation to seek to enter and to advance the kingdom of God. Are we thankful for all the love that he has shown us? We also love him, and we love his kingdom, and we desire that he be glorified. So not just for his love toward us, but for who he is and for what he is, because he is holy. Now, you know that once the Lord opens our eyes to see the beauty of something, and we find it to be beautiful, and our hearts go out to it, and we love it, you know that whatever your affections get set on, you want to have it. When you love someone, you want to be near them. When you love someone, you want to please them. Well, now with our eyes open to see the beauty of Jesus, with our hearts going out to Jesus, we have to have him, which is why we embrace him, why we take him to be our Savior. We have to be near him. Which is why, like David, we want to be near those things that reveal to us the beauty of our Lord. We want to please him as we want to please those whom we love. Now, when you love someone, you also tend to love what is dear to them. What is dear to the Lord Jesus? His kingdom is dear to him. And so if you love the Lord, you'll love his kingdom. And if you love his kingdom, you'll also want to advance his kingdom. As a matter of fact, you'll see everything that is standing against it, everything that is the opposite of it, the kingdom of this world. You'll be grieved by that and want it to, be defeated, want it to go away so that his kingdom might advance. As a matter of fact, having seen the beauty of the kingdom, having that desire for what is good and right, you want everything to be as the Lord would have it to be. You want everything to be holy. And everything you see in the world that is that is against that, that is contrary to that, that is not holy, you'll find that to be offensive. You'll find that to be oppressive. You'll find it to be something that grieves you because it is contrary to what your Lord wants. It's contrary to what you want because you also want holiness. And I believe that that is why Peter wrote what he did regarding Lot in 2 Peter 2, verses 7 and 8. He says, Lot was oppressed by the sensual conduct of unprincipled men. For by what he saw and heard, that righteous man, while living among them, felt his righteous soul tormented day after day by their lawless deeds. When you love what is holy, you will be grieved over what is unholy. And you'll have the same reaction that Lot had. Now, Lot lived in Sodom and Gomorrah. Things were pretty bad there, but I mean, just take a look around you. Things are getting like that pretty quickly. When you love holiness, when you love the Lord for his holiness and you love the holiness of his kingdom, you will want to see everything become what the Lord says it should be, because that's what's right and that's what's good. And you won't be happy, fully happy, satisfied until you see those things. Because you love his kingdom, you will strive to enter it, because it is the only thing that will satisfy your desire for holiness. The Spirit that Jesus gives us is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the author of holiness. He is one who loves holiness with a perfect love, and he is the one who gives love for that same holiness to those he indwells. Now that's how we can know that we have the Spirit of God living in us, because we will not only want to be holy ourselves, but we'll want everyone else to be holy as well, which is why we will do what we can to try to encourage one another to holiness in that direction. I mean, we'll do it not with a whip, but we'll do it with love. And that's why we'll share the gospel with our neighbors who don't know him. One thing holiness does, of course, is it as I've said, it's a love for what is good and what is right. Well, what is good and what is right? What God tells us in his word, in his law, and what does his law say? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So having a love for what the Lord calls us to do, we will reach out to our neighbor and we'll seek to love him by bringing him the gospel, so that he too might find the Lord's holiness, might be saved, and begin to live the kind of life that's honoring to the Lord, the kind of life that is also pleasing to us, because we want the same things that the Lord wants. The fact that it's the Spirit who gives us this desire for holiness is also why it's so important for us to use all that the Lord has given to us to have more of his influence in our lives. The more we have of him, the more we will have this desire, and the more we're going to seek the kingdom of heaven, because our love for holiness will be stronger. The stronger it is, the more we'll seek it. But the less we have, the less we'll desire it, and the less we will seek his kingdom. So it shouldn't be surprising to us that Paul, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, commands us to be filled with the Spirit. Ephesians 5:18. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. But be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit, why? Because when you're filled with the Spirit, you will desire to be holy, and you will desire everything else to be holy as well. That is what you will want, and you'll press ahead in that area. That's why when the early disciples prayed, after they had been threatened and released, they came back and they all prayed together. God answered their prayer by filling them with the Holy Spirit, and as soon as he filled them with the Holy Spirit, the first thing they did is they went out and told other people about Jesus, because they wanted to promote the kingdom of holiness. Luke writes in Acts 4:31, and when they had prayed, the place where they had gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God with boldness. And that's, of course, why when we don't have strong desires to advance the kingdom of holiness and strive to enter into it as the Lord calls us to, that what we need to do is pray and ask the Lord for more of His Spirit, because He is the only one who can do this work within us. And you know, the good news is that's what the Spirit wants to do. He wants to do this work in us if we are only willing to let Him work through us, if we are willing to be used by Him. And so, in closing, let me just simply say this. Let the love that the Lord has shown you, as we looked at this morning, move you to seek His kingdom, to strive to enter His kingdom. But don't forget also to stoke the fire of your love for Him, your love for the kingdom of heaven, your love for the King, your love for Jesus Christ, and that He would be glorified and that He would have His people gathered to Him. Don't forget to stoke the fire of your love for Him by using the means that God has given to you to be filled with the presence of His Spirit. If God commands us to be filled, then it certainly is possible to be filled. That's what He desires. And so that's what we need to do if we would be filled with this love that will move us in that direction more powerfully than anything else that we can possibly do, be filled with the Spirit. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer and let's ask the Lord to fill us with the Spirit, give us this zeal and this desire so that we might be able to do more effectively what He calls us to do.